Yeah, I got something to say. I got a few last words. This is what I gotta say. You don't know. You don't know anything about me. You don't know anything about the world, about reality. Got it? I mean, who the hell are you people? Who are you to say he dies? What gives you that right? My peers? My jury of peers? You're not my peers because I look down on you. You and your TV brains. You and your stupid existence. You never been anywhere. You don't know nothing. All you know is what some idiot on the boob tube tells you. So maybe I killed those girls. So what? I didn't. But what if I did? Insignificant people die every day. You don't seem to be too concerned when there's a war going on or there's children starving in Africa. What about that, huh? You're responsible for that, and you're responsible for putting me away. I mean, first of all, I'm innocent, okay? But second of all, I'm somebody because I have seen the world. I have been in the desert, man, and I have seen the shining star. I have rode with the kings, man, and I have rode with the best. I know what the truth is. And the truth is that I count and you don't. It's like when you're a little kid and you step on ants on the sidewalk. You know they don't count. Well, it's the same with me. You're just a bunch of ants. You're not even alive as far as I know. You could just be a bunch of robots. You might be robots filled with blood and guts, but you're still robots, see? See, I can see that. I understand that. Because I have seen the shining star in the desert, man. I have rode a Harley at 150 miles an hour, and I saw reality go by. I have been through it. I have tripped in places you don't even know exist. I shot dope in the Mekong, man. I looked death right in the eyes, and I saw stars and stripes. And no one can dispute me. Those who have tried are very sorry now. They're not around to talk about it. Because I'm always ready, see? Here's a war coming on, and this is only the beginning. Only the strong will survive. It's going to be kill or be killed, hand to hand, mind to mind. And I'm ready, see? I don't pump iron for nothing. I'm building up, getting ready. I do yoga. I do meditation. I get stronger and stronger every day. Make myself harder and harder every day. Going out further and further and further. Closer to the shining star. It's like cosmic, like oriental. You got to go all the way out and come all the way back in. And keep your center. Like if there was a candle here, right now, I could put my hand over it. I wouldn't get burned. I won't feel any pain at all. Because I can take it, see? You people. You people living out your safe, protected little lives, you think you know about things? You think you can tell me about things? You can't tell me about nothing, man, because I have seen it all. I shook hands with the devil. And you want to come here? And you want to fight with me? And you will lose, man. You will lose. Because I am the stronger one. And the stronger one always wins. That's the law of the jungle. At survival of the fittest. And I am the stronger, physically, mentally, and spiritually. See, that's a big joke, see? See, you're just here because I'm here. You just came here tonight to see me. I'm the one. I'm sitting up here, you're just sitting out there scared. There's the killer. We gotta kill the killer. You're afraid of me. Like Jesus. You think you just put me away and that's the end of it? That's where you're wrong, man. You can't get rid of me. I'm everywhere. I'm in the air. I'm in the ground. I'm inside you. See, the shining star doesn't go away. It's always there in my head, burning, shining in my brain. And when everything's gone, when everything gets blown away, I'll still be here.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. I am so happy to see so many happy, smiling faces here tonight. I am turned on by the energy I feel in this room here tonight. I can feel that energy coming right down from the balconies, right through the audience, right up through the floorboards, right through my legs, my chest, my head. I am exploding with the energy, the potential for change I feel in this room here tonight. You know, I go over this great country of ours, I talk to people just like you, and I talk to them about personal change. And everywhere I go, people ask me the same question. They say, Phil, what is the secret of happiness? What is the secret of joy, of ecstasy? And everywhere I go, I tell people a story I once heard about a little boy. Went into a candy store. All he had was a nickel. He took his nickel into the candy store, and he looked at all the kinds of candy that was there, and he picked out the candy bar he wanted more than any other. And he said to the man behind the counter, he said, "Sir, I like that candy bar right there." The man looked at the little boy, looked at his nickel, and he said, "Sorry, son, it's a 10-cent candy bar. All you've got is a nickel." The boy was disappointed. But he thought, and he thought, and he thought, and he came up with an idea. He said, "Why don't we compromise? Why don't we take that candy bar and cut it in half? And you take half, and I'll have half for myself. How about that?" The man smiled at little boy. He said, "Son, it's a 10-cent candy bar. You'll get your skinny ass out of my store, get me another nickel, and I'll sell it to you." With that, the man turned his back on the little boy. The little boy stood there, dejected, rejected, abandoned by this man. And he looked at the nickel in his hand. And he looked at the man's broad back turned against him. And then he looked at the candy bar he wanted so much. And you know what he did? He reached out and he kind of touched that candy bar. And then he reached out and he kind of held that candy bar. And then he ran out the store with the candy bar. And as he was running down the street, he realized something. He still had his nickel in his hand. And in his other hand, he had a whole candy bar. And he was suddenly filled with a tremendous feeling of happiness and joy and ecstasy. Now, let me ask you something. When was the last time you felt that good? I bet you can't even remember. I bet you can't even remember. I feel that good every day because I am in touch with something deep inside of me. I'm going to teach you how to be in touch with the same thing deep inside of you. See, a few years ago, I was in a terrible place in my life. I was depressed. I was like most of you here tonight, almost suicidal. I had reached I was scraping bottom. And I had to do some soul searching, and I was doing some soul searching, and I heard a voice. I heard a voice. And I looked behind me, and there on the floor of my soul, so to speak, was somebody talking to me. And he said, "Hey, Phil, remember me?" And I looked through the mists, and there was a little baby there. I had discovered my inner baby within. I reached out, and I picked up that baby, because you see, I have a baby who lives inside of me. And that baby has to be picked up every once in a while, doesn't it? That baby has to be held. That baby has to be coddled. Has to have things go its own way every once in a while. Has to cry once in a while. Has to piss on people, shit on people. That's the baby who lives inside of me. And the good news... the good news I have for all of you here tonight is that there's a little baby inside of you. I don't care how old or ugly, perverse or disturbed you might be. You were once a beautiful little baby. I'm going to teach you how to get in touch with that little baby. I'm going to teach you how to pick up that little baby. You're going to pick it up right now. I want you to reach inside of you. I know you can feel that baby inside of you. Pick up that baby and put it on your lap. Go ahead. And while you're holding that baby on your lap, I want you to think for a second about little babies. Think about little babies. Ever see them playing on the floor and they're just happy? They don't worry about tomorrow or yesterday. They don't worry about did they hurt somebody's feelings today? Did they get to work late? Did they smoke too much, eat too much, break the speed limit? No. Babies are in the now. They are connected to their centers. They are rude. They are crude. They are selfish. And they are happy. And what do to these perfectly happy little perfect human beings? What do to them? Why, we take them, don't we? And we build a wall around them made out of all these adult things. Anger, resentments, pessimism, negativity, ambition. We build that wall around that poor little baby until that baby is bricked in, stuck inside, like a little tiny Marcel Marceau cannot get out. I want you to break those walls down. Let your baby go. Stop worrying about tomorrow. Stop worrying about yesterday. Stop worrying what other people think about you all the time. What other people think about you is none of your business. Forget about other people. Stop worrying about everything all the time. Yes, the world is a complicated place, but worrying about it all the time is going to make it any less complicated. Stop worrying about everything. The world has been around for 20 million years without your help. It does not need your help. The whales don't need you. The dolphins don't need you. The ozone doesn't need you. Your baby needs you. I want you to take that baby's hand and let that baby lead you to a new life of happiness and joy and healthy selfishness. And I'm going to teach you how to do that. You're going to get up every morning and you're going to do what I tell you to do. You're going to get up every morning, you're going to look in the mirror every single morning, and you're going to look yourself right in the eyes. And every single morning, you're going to look at yourself and you're going to say, "What about me?" When's it going to be my turn? What about my baby? You're 15 minutes late for work, your boss is pissed off at you. Too bad, fuck you! My baby needed the sleep. You forget to send your mother a Mother's Day card. Sorry, Mom, you'll just have to wait till next year. I'm busy being the mother you never were. You're driving around for 20 minutes trying to find a parking space. Only place to park is that handicapped parking lot. Park there. Your inner baby is handicapped, too. Go ahead. You sit in front of the TV set. You got a pile of Haagen-Dazs cartons on your stomach there. You're sucking down the Slim Jims or the Doritos. Go ahead. Feed that baby. Your baby's hungry. Feed it. You could even try it tonight. You know, when you go out to the ladies' room, the men's room later on, and you're standing in line and it's taking forever, you don't have to be doing that. Just let it go. Let it go. Don't it feel wonderful? Of course it does. And when your baby feels wonderful, you feel wonderful. And when you feel wonderful, there's one more wonderful person in this world. And guess what? You've just made the world a better place. See how easy that is? Okay. We're going to break into groups now. I'm going to come around to talk to each one of your inner babies. Individually. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bonjour, guys.
Who the hell is that?
Who?
Jesus Christ.
I'm not quite General Cooper, although I have sort of risen from the dead. No, it's just your old friend, Travis Dane. You remember, the guy you fired.
And I bet just about now you're probably asking yourselves, what the hell did we just shoot down?
The answer is the NSA's best and only functional real-time downlooking satellite, the NSP-1. Not a bad piece of hardware. You'd probably be calling them any minute now and asking them for its use. Unfortunately, since even they don't know where the fuck it is, they're not gonna be much help.
Have you got him? Have you got him?
But
I'm closing in.
You roughly know where the last transmission came from, so you're probably closing in pretty fast on Grazier One's probable location. Yep, it's in there somewhere, hiding among those 50 ghost satellites I've created just for you. Grazier One is viable and can produce results, reproducible results. And to prove it, I'm going to be kind enough to give you another demonstration of my masterpiece. In 45 minutes, as soon as Grazier One's in position for a clear shot, I'm going to hit the Pentagon with a 98% blast. More than enough to fracture the nuclear reactor you say you don't have under there.
Bitch.
We'll have fallout. We'll have devastation. And I've got things to do. Oh, I want you to remember something. I was smarter than all of you before I worked there. I was smarter than all of you while I worked there. And I'm still smarter than all of you. Au revoir.
Terry! Terry, you going to the store? Get me a pack of cigarettes, please. Marlboro, side pack. Get me a ring ding, too. I didn't have no breakfast or nothing. Come on, man, please. Thank you. Oh. Joey, where was you last night, man? We was doing lewds, man. We was looking all over the place for you, man. Come on. Me and Frankie and Sally and Joni, man. We had a great fucking time, man. Doing lewds, driving around, smoking J's, drinking beers. Kind of quiet night, you know what I mean? Oh, man, you should have been there then. We're driving along, right? We're driving. And, like, I'm not getting off in the lewds, right? So I turn to Frankie, I says, Frankie, I'm not getting off in these lewds, right? Frankie just turns to me, he goes, don't worry, man, you will. You know what that wisdom that he's got, you know? So, like, I'm driving, and I looks down, and I see, like, a little piece of dirt on my shoe, right? You know me, I'm neat and clean, I don't like getting nothing on my clothes or nothing, right? So I keep looking down the dirt, dirt's looking at me, and I reaches down and I start scratching a piece of dirt off my shoe, right? I'm driving a car, right? I'm not fucking around or nothing, right? I'm scratching. All of a sudden, out of fucking nowhere, boom, this guardrail comes wrapping up around a car, right? Car starts spinning around and shit. Chicks are screaming in the back seat. Cars are honking their horns all around me and shit. Bang, we go over the guardrail. We're on the other side of the highway now, right? We're going down the other side of the highway. Cars are like blinking their headlights at me and shit, you know? Like, I don't know, I'm on the wrong side of the road or something. So anyways, bang, we go down into this gully. We all get out of the car. Frankie just walks right up to the car, right? He just like looks at the car and he goes, fuck the fucking car, man. The fucking car's fucked. We used to come up with that shit, you know what I mean? He's got a line like that all day long.
David, come on in, just take a seat. We just got the results back from the lab, and they're good. Lots of positive indicators. I'll let you take the lab results home with you when you leave. Now, David, just sit down, David. Just to be on the safe side, I'd like to start you on some medication. I can't say it's going to do anything, but on the other hand, it can't hurt either. Okay? All right. Now, David, this medicine does have some side effects. I just want you to know what those are in case anything comes up, you don't get overly concerned. All right? No, okay. Now, David, after you're on this drug for a couple of days, you will notice some blurring of vision. Just means the medicine's working. Don't worry about that. Okay? And you will experience a diminishment of your sex drive. To a great extent. I'd be surprised if any sex drive at all, actually, after about 2 weeks on this stuff. Now, David, sometimes in the morning, you're going to get up in the morning, you're going to feel a little dizzy. Don't worry about that. What you might find worrisome, though, is sometimes when you're taking a shower, you're going to be losing some hair, clumps of hair. Might get some bald spots on your head here and there. If that's causing you a lot of distress, I would prescribe a hat is good for that. Also, itching is very common. We find there's itching on the arms, on the legs, on the palms of the hands, the soles of the feet. You might even get what we call an epidermal sebaceous trauma, which is just a fancy term for large bleeding scabs on your arms and on your legs. If you're having a problem with that, just call up Heidi at the front desk and she'll give you a prescription for hydrocortisone cream. Clear that right up. Shouldn't have any. I won't charge you for the visit. Come by anytime you want. Just pick it up. Numbness is also common in the fingertips, the ears, the nose, the toes, all the extremities. Might have a little problem picking up small objects on certain days. How shall I say this? You may experience some temporary blindness. It's only temporary, has no medical significance. You got to get up in the morning, you won't be able to see for a little while, you know, 15 or 20 minutes. Just sit on the edge of your bed, wait it out, you know. If an hour goes by, you still can't see, be sure to give me a call, of course, okay? Also in the morning, nausea, vomiting, incontinence is very common. If you're having a problem holding your bowels, just call Heidi at the front desk. She'll give you something, firm you right up. And I do tell all my patients on this drug, keep your meals small. You will be throwing up quite a bit. Bleeding can be unexpected. Find there's a little sensitivity in the nasal passages. You get a little slight hemorrhaging there. Actually, it's kind of a funny story. I have a patient who's been on this drug now for, gee, must be 2 years now, and they were having a birthday party. Took him to this very fancy restaurant. You know these places, they take forever to bring the food, and they're waiting for the entree. Finally, the food arrives. He looks down at the plate. Drops of blood start falling into the plate. Well, they brought him another entree, of course. So just keep a handkerchief with you at all times, and do not blow, whatever you do. Just dab lightly, And that's it. We'll do some more tests in about 3 months, see what kind of results we're getting. If we don't like the results, we'll put you in something stronger. Okay? All right, David. No, don't thank me. Just the miracle of modern medicine. Oh, thank you, David. Thank you. You look very well yourself also. Yes. Oh, David, I almost forgot. We got that insurance claim back from the insurance company. Yeah, they're not going to pay. No. So do you think you'd drop a check off with Heidi on your way out? Yeah, for the whole amount, for the whole $7,000 would be good. Okay? All right, David. Okay. You too. Take care.
Thank you so much for joining me tonight on this path of spiritual recovery. Let me remind each and every one of you that you are full of energy. With this energy, you can change your lives. Together, we can change the world. The first thing you must understand in order to harness this energy is that you are nothing. You do not exist. There is no you. You are only a temporary vessel for the use of the universe to make manifest this moment and this time. You are one stitch in the vast carpet of the cosmos. You are one grain of sand in the endless cosmos. You are one hair on the butt of the hairy gorilla. The second thing you must understand is that we exist in two states. We are either in sync with the universe or we are out of sync with the universe. When we are in sync with the universe, we call this being harmonious. When we are out of sync with the universe, we call this being alienated. We are either harmonious or we are alienated. How do we know which state we are in? We just know. So let us now clear our minds and still our centers, and let us contemplate these two states of being. Harmony and alienation. I am warm. I am happy. I am harmonious. I am cold. I am angry. I am alienated. I am swimming in my heated Olympic-sized swimming pool. I am harmonious. I am doing my taxes and discovered that I owe the IRS $60,000. I am alienated. I am buying my brand new Lexus with all leather interior. I am harmonious. I am talking on the phone with health insurance to discover they will not pay $400,000 for my cancer tumor to be removed. I am alienated. I am flying first class to St. Bart's. I am harmonious. I am going to jail for credit card fraud. I am alienated. When we contemplate these two states of being, a deep and abiding spiritual principle becomes obvious. Alienation is simply a lack of money. And of course, the corollary, money brings deep and abiding harmony. When we have money, we are always happy. Everyone is our friend, and the sun is always shining. When we lack money, we are angry, we yell a lot, we are often constipated, and we listen to punk music. And so, each one of us is on a journey. A journey of discovery, a path to answer the eternal question, how do I get more money? That is why I am here. That is why you are joining me tonight. The paradox of life is paradoxical. In order to breathe in, we must first exhale. In order for the sun to rise, it must first set. In order to shit, we must first eat. In order to take what I have to give you, you must give me $4,000 in 4 easy installments. Life presents us with an endless cornucopia of goods and services. We only have to pay for them. Shanti.
Frank, what did he say? What did he say? He's gonna sue me? He's gonna sue me? He's fucking with here, Frank. He's talking with God here, Frank. Did you tell him that? You know what God does when he gets angry, Frank? Ever hear of Sodom and Gomorrah, Frank? That's what I'm gonna do to his face, okay? No, Frank, I don't wanna hear it, all right? I don't wanna hear another word. I'm gonna blow him away. I'm gonna peel his skin off. I'm gonna drink his blood. I'm gonna eat his children, Frank. I'm gonna enjoy myself. You wanna know why? This guy's a schmuck, a schlemiel, and a shithead for fucking with me, Frank. He should know better than that. No, Frank, I'm not listening, all right? I'm not listening to another word. No, Frank. La 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 la. I'm not listening, Frank. Call him back right now. Call him and tell him. Wait, don't even call him. Call his children. Get them ready to be eaten. Goodbye, Frank. Diane! Who's on line one? My wife put her on hold. What's for lunch? I'm starving to death. I don't care, Diane, anything. I don't care, Diane, anything. I am starving to death. I don't want that. I don't want that either. No monkfish. No monkfish, no arugula, no sun-dried tomatoes, no whole wheat tortellini. I want food. You know what food is, Diane? You ever hear of it before? Unlike you, Diane, I am a human being. I need food, I need coffee. Please get me some. Call Jeff Cavanaugh, put him on line 2. Call Dave Simpson, put him on line 3. Thank you! Hi, honey. I know, I tell her time and time again, don't put my wife on hold. She puts you on hold. I'm sorry. What'd you do today? That's nice. How much did that cost? No. Spend the money. That's what it's there for. That's what it's there for. How's Jeremy? Why did he do that? Why did he bite the kid, Sonya? I mean, I told him. I did not tell him to bite anybody. I did not tell him. Sonya, don't tell me what I tell him, all right? I told him. Can I talk here, please? I told him. The next time a little boy does something to you, do twice as much back to him. That is what I said. I don't care what his therapist says. His therapist is a codependent dysfunctional fraud, all right? I don't want to hear about his therapist. No. You know what I'm going to say to Jeremy? I'm going to say, Jeremy, bite your therapist. That's what I'm going to say. She can work on that for a couple of months. What else? How'd she do that? How'd she fit it in the microwave, Sonya? What is this, 3 microwaves we've broken in the last year? No. You know, if you just hired somebody from a country where they had electricity, we wouldn't have these problems all the time. You have to tell her, that's all. Turn it on, plug it in the wall. I mean, she'll quit. She won't quit. She has it great. She has it great, Sonya. She spends all day in a luxury New York apartment. I spend all day in this office killing myself so she can spend all day in my luxury New York apartment. She spends more time there than I do. I'm not shouting. This is not shouting. Am I shouting? Is this shouting? Am I shouting? I'm not shouting. This is not shouting. I am discussing. We are having a normal discussion. 2 normal human beings are having a normal conversation. Well, maybe you're just a little too agitated right now to have this conversation. Why don't we wait until I get home? We could talk about it then. Around 9. I have a lot of work to do. Sonya, do you think I like slaving and sweating here all hours of the night and day so that you and Jeremy can be safe and free? Do you? It hasn't been 2 weeks. It hasn't been 2 weeks. We just did it. We did it just recently. I know we did. We'll have sex tomorrow night, all right? I won't forget. I'll put it in my book. Listen, honey. I'm sorry. Next month, we'll go down to St. Bart's for a couple of weeks. We'll spend a couple of weeks on the beach. We'll get a nice place by the beach. We'll make love every day on the beach, all right? You won't get sand in your crotch. Will you stop it, please, with this crazy... Listen, I have to get off the phone. I have 15 million phone calls to make. Huh? No, don't cut your hair. Don't color your hair. Don't henny hair. Don't start with the hair blackmail now, Sonya. Come on. I have too many things to do here. I like it the way you looked this morning when I left. That's the way I like it, all right? Just like that. When I come home tonight, that's the way you should look, all right? I'm getting off the phone. All right, give Jeremy a kiss goodnight for me. All right, yeah, say hi to your mother for me, too. Okay. All right. Okay. All right. All right. All right. What? Orange juice. I won't forget. I don't have to write it down. I can remember orange juice. I'm not a moron. Listen, all right. All right. Okay. All right. All right. Okay. Nighty night. I'll be home around 10:30. Bye. Diane! What are you doing in there? Growing the crops or what? Come on, let's go. I feel like a poster child for Ethiopian relief here. My ribs are sticking out. I got flies crawling around my face. Come on, let's go. Let's move it. Jeff, how they hanging, man? Not bad. Yes. Yeah. I finished that deal up this morning. I don't know. I made about 85 grand in the deal, something like that. Take this, man. I made a deal this afternoon. I made 150 grand, man. You know what they say? 100 grand here, 100 grand there. Pretty soon you're talking real money. They have to pay me, man. They have to pay me. They don't pay me, I go next door, I make twice as much. It's like Bruce says, man. No surrender, no return. Rock on, man. I don't know. I was thinking maybe I'd buy a Porsche for the country house, park it from the tennis court, piss off the neighbors. Not even drive it, just leave it there all the time. No, I can't drive it. I don't drive a stick. Those are good. Yeah, what is that? Range Rovers. They're good, right? They're like four-wheel drives. Very ecological, right? Yeah, maybe I'll get one of those. Maybe I'll get two of those, whatever. No, I can't. Not tonight. I'm doing something. Who am I doing? I'm not telling you. Jeff, I tell you, you're going to tell Nadine, she's going to tell Sonia. Very beautiful. Better. Better than her. Better than her. Yes, she has legs. Yes, she has breasts. She has arms, she has a head, I got the whole package. Jeff, the closest you ever came to a woman this beautiful is that time you bought that scratch and sniff picture of Vanna White. And dig this, man, she's an artist. She's very, very sensitive. She was in a bar, she picked me up. How could I say no? Jeff, unlike you, I am still committed to my 60s idealism. I am still committed to experience and exploration. I didn't sell out the way you did, man. I'm still committed to these things as a matter of principle. Listen, why don't we get together tomorrow night over at my club, play a little handball over at the club, have a couple of pops afterwards, okay? Now, my club, Jeff, my club. My club is nicer than your club. It's safer, it's cleaner. They don't let those weird people in, they let in over your place. Okay, I gotta get back to work here, Jeff. I gotta like make a little money here, unlike you. All right? Thank you. Thank you very much. I am a genius. I am the best. No one get close to me. I'll let you get close to me, Jeff. You can blow me. Bye! Dave, I agree with you 150%. The man is a wonderful human being. I love him. He's a wonderful, wonderful man. I felt terrible having to let him go. I know he has his pension coming up, Dave. I understand that. But Dave, I know he's losing his pension. I know he's 58 years old. You're not telling me anything I don't know here, Dave. But wait, Dave. Something you may not know about him and me is that when I first came to work at this company, this guy was like a father to me, all right? I love this man like my own father, okay? I love him. It broke my heart to have to let him go, Dave. I know he's going for major surgery next week. I'm not his doctor, Dave. I'm his boss. No, Dave. You know, you're missing something here now. Dave. The guy is not producing anymore. He's easy listening. This place is rock and roll. I need production. I need profits here, Dave. Come. No, Dave. No, wait a second. You listen to me for a second, all right? You've been talking nonstop now for 5 minutes. Let me get in two words edgewise here, please. Now, let me just ask you something here, Dave. Just one simple question. You like your new house in the country, Dave? But I just want to know. You like your new house in the country? You do. Okay. You like your new swimming pool you just got? You do. Okay. You like your new Mercedes station wagon? You do? Okay, all right. You like that new horse school you send your daughter to? You like your new car phone? You like long lunches, Dave? Huh? Dave, what do you think pays for those things, Dave? No, what do you think pays for those things? Profits, Dave. Say profits. just say, I want to hear you say profits. Say profits. Just say it. Say it! Thank you. Now, when the profit axe comes down, Dave, anybody's head could roll. I could lose my job tomorrow. You could lose your job tomorrow. You could lose your job today. You could lose your job in the next 5 minutes again with this stupid conversation. Because I tell you the truth, Dave, I'm going to get rid of the guy even more now. Because now he's wasting his time. He sits around wasting time. He's wasting your time. Both of you guys sitting around wasting time. You're wasting my time. And all these people in this company here sitting around wasting time. I say, so what's the point, Dave? What is the point? What is the fucking goddamn point? Is there any fucking goddamn point is, please? Dave! You're not sure. Well, let me ask you this, Dave. I just, out of my own curiosity, I want to know, are you happy here working at this company? I just want to, you spend all day making crazy phone calls and you're not working. I just want to, are you happy here working with us at this company? You are. Well, I just want you to be happy, Dave, so get back to work, all right? Okay. All right. Okay. Okay, I can dig it, man. Okay. All right. No. It's all right. It's forgotten. Look, I hold no grudges, all right? Okay. All right. Yeah, I will. You say hi to Jody for me, okay? Judy, right, Judy. Say hi to Judy for me. Okay, Dave. All right. Okay. Bye-bye. Diane, let me make it easy for you. Take your hand, put it in the microwave oven, grill it, bring it in to me. Who's on line 4? I got it. Hi there. Nothing. Making money. What else do I do? Yeah? I'm working very, very hard. Now that you call, it's getting harder and harder. What are you doing? You're making a sculpture? Yeah? You're working in your studio? Yeah? What kind of sculpture you making? You're making a sculpture of a horse and you wrote the word horse all over it? It's very conceptual, Yvette. What do you mean I sound bored? I'm not bored at all. I love talking about your art, Yvette. Yvette, I love talking about you. I was just telling somebody 5 minutes ago what a wonderful art you have. Yvette, can I tell you something? If you were 100 years old and you were as ugly as a clock, I would still love you. And you want to know why? Because I love your art, that's why. Of course I mean it. Of course I mean it. And you say these things to me and you get me all upset. I'm going to have to come over there later on. I'm going to be all full of this weird feelings. I don't know what I'm going to do. I might have to, like, give you a nice little spanking on your bottom. Yeah? What else are you going to do? All over my body? Dude, that would hurt. What I do to deserve all this attention? I am a pretty nice guy, aren't I? I love you too. I love you too, Yvette. Yvette, when I say from me to you, I love you, I mean I love you. No one in the world knows what it means to say I love you the way that I mean I love you when I say from me to you, I love you. Because no one in the world has ever loved the way that I'm loving when I love you. My life would have no meaning if I didn't love you. Of course I mean it. Of course I mean it. Would I lie to you? Listen, Yvette, my boss just came running in the office. He's got a big bunch of pay yelling at me. Everything's crazy here. When am I going to see you? Around 6 o'clock tonight? Over at the loft? Okay, make a big bunch of sculptures for me, all right? All right, ciao to you too. All right. Okay. Diane, cut the food, cut the coffee, bring in Mailox, a shoeshine boy, hold my calls. Thank you.
I open my eyes to the ragged skies of another hot city morning. The sirens scream The beggar's dream, a hooker shouts a warning. I know this place, I've been here before. It hasn't changed in 100 years of beers and tears and leers and sneers and fears in the asphalt-covered, blood-encrusted, copper-jacketed, broken glass-ornamented highways and byways of a never-never land called Take Me Out to the Ball Game, baby. Honey child, suck my dick in the thick of the midnight fog when the razors get sharpened and the works get filled and the red flowers blossom and the dragon's tail gets chased. I live in the underground. I am the dog, the mongrel, the hound, bopping and rapping to the sound of the city primeval. I howl at the skyscrapers. Arr! 'Cause life's a bitch. Amen.
We are living in a human nightmare. You can't walk down the street for fear of being assaulted. You can't ride an airplane for fear of being hijacked or blown up. Every corner newsstand openly sells vicious pornography. Every doctor's office perfectly happy to perform an abortion on you or on your daughter. Our children are subjected daily to the perversions of their school teachers, and when they come home from school, they got nothing better to do than to watch TV, take drugs, learn how to become homosexuals and rapists. What a lovely world, is it not? This is the world we live in today. This is America. Take a look. Take a good look. And tell me what you see. This is the work of Satan. The Satan is here in this world today. He is here with us right now. Satan is sitting here with us right now, and he's laughing. He's laughing at us because he seduced us with a life of plenty and he invited us into hell. And we all went, didn't we? We couldn't wait to get down there fast enough. We're all going down to hell. You're going and 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 your children are going and your children's children. As the blind lead the blind, as the damned lead the damned, onward into oblivion. We're going down to hell. Unless we do what we know is right. Unless we do what God knows we have to do. If you have to take a bottle, fill it full of gasoline, light it on fire, throw it into one of these satanic abortion clinics, then you do it. If you have to close down one of these goddamn art centers, then you do it. If you have to arrest these pornographic-speaking Negroes, then you do it. If you have to take a handgun and shoot them down, you do it. If you have to take an atomic device and light it off over one of these big-nosed, curly-haired, Semitic, Iraqi countries, then you do it. You do what you have to do. You do what you know is right. Because this is the world where Satan walks. Where Satan walks and where Satan laughs. Where Satan says to himself, I won. I beat him. I beat them all.
We start hitchhiking down the highway. And like this van comes along, right? Like a hippie van, right? With like peace sign on it and shit, right? Door pops open, guy driving the van's got hair down to his balls, right? Beads, incense, flowers, Grateful Dead music, right? Complete asshole, right? Figure, what the fuck, right? Get inside the van, right? Beggars can't be choosers. Jody gets in the front, me and Frankie gets in the back with Sally, right? We start driving down the road. Joey, this guy starts rolling joints. Monster fucking joints, all right? Like the size of your dick, okay? Size of my dick, all right? Monsters. Made out of some kind of weed, man. I don't know. This weed, you smoke one toke, you're paralyzed the rest of your life, right? Me and Frankie, we're sitting in the back seat. We're just doing, like, experiments. How many brain cells we could kill in one toke, right? It's just like, you know, just getting completely, like, fucked out of our brains, right? Even the Grateful Dead music starting to sound good, right? It's like, talking with the dude, man.
Anyway, and then the ludes kicks in, right? So we're just like, blah. Melted right into the fucking upholstery, right? Frankie, we're getting smashed. Frankie looks in the front seat. This guy driving a van, he's got his hand on Joni's leg, right? So like Frankie says, you know, what's he gonna say? He goes, yo man, take your hand off my girlfriend's leg, right? Guy turns around to Frankie, he says, yo man, fuck you, right? To Frankie, he says this, right? So what's Frankie gonna do? He takes out his knife, he opens it up, he says, no man, fuck you, right? Guy reaches into the glove compartment, takes out a handgun, points it at Frankie's head, he says, no man, fuck you, right? I'm fucking shitting my pants here, all right? I do not like fucking ride around in cars where people have like guns and knives and shit, like pointing them at each other, you know? So anyways, the guy's still driving a van, right? So he turns around, keep driving. Frankie takes his knife, bing, little tiny cut, the back of the neck, right? Nothing big, just a little tiny scratch, right? Guy gets all fucking pissed off, right? Pulls the van over the side, starts waving a gun. Okay, everybody get out of the van right now. Everybody get out of the van right now, right? So what's Frankie gonna do, right? He takes his knife, he closes it up nice, puts it in his back pocket. Ba, 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 boom, 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 ba, ba, boom. Gets him outside the van. Ba, ba, boom, boom. Breaking the guy's fucking ribs and shit, right? grabs the fucking gun off the guy. We all jump back inside the van. We take off down the highway. Frankie! I mean, I understand. I mean, a lot of people have an attitude. Probably most of you have an attitude. You come in here and you kind of, you know, you give me that sort of, you know, you're judging me. You come in and you judge me. I mean, I don't know what you've been doing tonight. You were out someplace, you had some Indian food, maybe, or maybe some pan pizza, and you come in here and have a couple of beers, hit a vase. I don't know what you do with your fucking, you know, your private life, and you come in here and you judge me. You judge me. Oh, he's not that great. He just plays assholes. I know plenty of assholes already. I can do without him. Hey, I can do without you, all right? You're not crazy about me, I'm not crazy about you, all right? He's angry. He's angry. He's the cutting edge of the black hole of the American psyche. Fuck that shit, all right? I'm not fucking angry. I'm happy. I'm a happy guy because I like to be positive. I know it's very important in America today to be positive, to be up, and I'm up, I'm positive, okay? I'm a happy guy. I'm a child of nature, born to lose. People call me poison, but that's no news. When I get up in the morning and I take a pee, I look into the mirror, what I see is me. A player, a winner, an unrepentant sinner. If you mess with me, I eat you for dinner. There are those that rule and those that serve. I'm the boss, baby, because I got the nerve to take what I want. Take what I need, cut your first sucker and make you bleed, cause life's a bitch, that I know. Don't misunderstand me, and then you go to your grave in a rocket, nothing in your pocket. If you got a gun, you better not cock it, cause then you die, that I know. What's left of you away will blow, and you will spend eternity praying to God you never met me. I mean, I'll tell you what I like. What I like is, I like the sound of a jackhammer breaking concrete around 6 o'clock in the morning. I like the dial tone real loud. I like the sound of an 80-year-old grandmother taking out her dentures for the night. I like those announcements they make in the supermarket when you're walking around, this week only, Alpo dog chips, only $19.95. I like news anchors seriously telling me about a really big plane crash and there's bodies all over the ground. That's what I like, okay? And I mean, I don't know what you like and what you don't like, but I'll tell you something right now. You take everybody in this room and you shave their heads and you strip them naked and you give them one watery bowl of gruel a day and you keep them locked in some cell someplace and doesn't make a flying fuck what you like. So thank you. Thank you very much for coming and I'll see you later.
I woke up this morning, man. I had a headache, man. You know why I had a headache? Because I got fucked up last night, man. And I woke up this morning, I had this fucking headache, man. And you know what I did? I got fucked up again, man. Because you want to know why?
because I hate the sound of coffee beans grinding, man. I hate the taste of fresh squeezed orange juice, man. I hate the sound of Brian Gumball's voice, man. I hate driving to work. I hate standing up. I hate breathing. I hate waiting to die, man. Why should I go to work? Why should I go to work? So some asshole who's got nothing better to do tells me what to do so he can feel better himself about himself so that maybe, just maybe, I can take home a check for $128.37 after they take out taxes and send them down to some cholesterol-filled, lying, cheating Paula fucking Titians so they can have free stamps and free haircuts and free blowjobs. Blow me. You know what I want to do, man? I want to get in a car and I want to hit about 80 miles an hour, man. And I don't want to be going down the highway and I want to have a head-on collision with a bus full of singing nuns from that movie Sister Act. And just before I hit the bus, I want to be shooting up heroin between my toes with one hand, and I'm going to be jerking off with the other hand. I'm going to be listening to Howard Stern on the radio so that when I die, I'll be laughing and coming at the same time, man. At least it wouldn't be so boring, man. I wouldn't be so fucking bored. I wouldn't be bored with all the stimulation, man. Oh, let's see what's on TV. Maybe something good is on tonight. Oh, did you read what it said in Vanity Fair about Woody fucking Allen? Oh, I just waxed my car. Doesn't it look nice? Oh, look at my tricep. I've been working out. Oh, I just love Robert De Niro movies. They're so real. Oh, I'm gonna get an earring and put it in my nose. Oh, I'm gonna get a baseball hat and turn it around backwards. Oh, I'm gonna get a tattoo. I'm gonna get a tattoo, man. I'm gonna get a tattoo on my eyes, man. It's gonna say, blow me, man. So every time somebody sees me, man, they know how I feel about them, man. Oh, I'm so worried about the recession. Oh, I'm so worried about Lyme disease. Oh, I'm so worried about the starving Africans. Oh, I'm so worried about the playoffs. Oh, I'm so worried about that stain on the rug. Oh, thank God. Thank God I'm not poor. Oh, thank God I don't have AIDS. Oh, thank God I'm not blind. Oh, thank God I'm not a nigger. Oh, thank God I'm not a faggot. Blow me, blow me, blow me. You know what I'm gonna do, man? I'm gonna find the biggest fucking pig I can find. Mud-covered pig. And I'm gonna get this huge erection. I'm gonna grease up that pig's asshole and lift up its little curly tail. I'm gonna shove it in. And while that pig is squealing with joy, man, I'm gonna be smoking crack out of a crack pipe. And I'm gonna have Sally Fields in this leather bondage outfit with a strap-on dildo. She's gonna be fucking me up the ass while hitting me on the head with a wooden mallet, man. Be a lot more fucking interesting than driving my Honda Accord, listening to my CD player in a 55 mile per hour zone. Be a lot more interesting than reading Time Magazine's analysis of Ronald Reagan's colon cancer. Be a lot more interesting than fucking flossing my fucking teeth, man. You know where we're descended from, man? We're descended from animals, man. You know what animals do all day, man? They eat and they sleep and they fuck and they bite each other, man. That's my genetic code. That's my genetic code. Eating, sleeping, fucking, and biting, man. All the rest is extra, man. You know what they say? If you can't run with the big dogs, hide under the porch. All that extra stuff they make up, man. All that extra stuff is just what the little dogs make up to get in my way, man. I was driving the other day, and this trooper pulls me over, man. And he comes up to the window of the car, and he says, "Son, do you realize how fast you were going?" And I say, "Why don't you tell me while you blow me?" I want to be ugly, man. I want to be fat, man. I want to be so fat that when other fat people see me, I cheer them up. I want to smell. I want all my teeth to fall out. I want to bang my head on the ground, man, until I'm unconscious. I want you to tie me up and whip my feet so that maybe, just maybe, I can feel something real for 2 or 3 minutes. So maybe, just maybe, I can stop all the noise.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I only want a few minutes of your time. It doesn't cost you anything to listen. Please be patient with me. I just got released from Rikers Island, where I was unjustly incarcerated for 30 days for acts I committed during a nervous breakdown due to a situation beyond my control. I am not a drug addict. This is the situation. I need your money. I could be out robbing and stealing right now. I don't want to be doing that. I could be holding a knife up to your throat right now. I don't want to be doing that. And I'm sure you don't want that either. Bad situations in my life forced me into the streets, into a life of crime. I won't bore you with the details right now, but if you don't believe me, you can call my parole officer. His home number is 555-2738. The only difference between you and me is that you're in the ups, I'm on the downs. Underneath it all, we're exactly the same. We're both human beings. I'm a human being. I'm a victim of a sick society. I come from a dysfunctional family. My father was an alcoholic. My mother tried to control me. My sister thinks she's an actress. You wouldn't want the childhood that I had. Please, please, look into your hearts. Do the right thing and help a human being. Thank you. Thank you. Sorry I interrupted your afternoon. Sorry. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Julia, and you're watching Video Wave, and tonight I've got one of my favorite performance artists on the show, Mr. Bogosian. He wrote Drinking in America, and he's going to tell us all about that tonight. Hi, Eric, how you doing tonight?
Good, Julia, how you doing?
Fine, let's start talking about Drinking in America. Where did you get the idea to do a show like that?
Well, it's not a hard idea to come up with. Just hanging around with my friends or anybody, or turning on a TV set, or going any place, pretty much people are either drinking or taking drugs or talking about how they're not drinking and not taking drugs anymore or something variation on that. Seems like a real classic American pursuit, so I decided to do a show about it.
One of the most interesting things about Drinking in America is that it's a solo work, but you're playing about 12 different characters there.
Yeah, well, I've always become different people. It's just a knack I have. I can become different people. So I decided when I wanted to start making performance, when I got to Soho in 1976 or whenever it was, I figured that's how I'd make my performances, but I'd make them out of people, just like a little collage or something. And so that's what I've ended up making is my shows are like usually 12 or 14 or 15 different groups of people, and by putting them together, that's what the show is.
Are these people you know or people from your imagination?
Well, they're people I know, but they're people I know from every place, like people on the street or people from my family or people from TV, or it's all just one big pot to draw from, and usually kind of twisted people because I find them a little more interesting.
Isn't everybody a little twisted?
Oh, that's my contention, yeah.
The thing about Drinking in America was, how long did it take to put something together like that? Because it seemed very researched.
Actually, it took around a year. I started collecting different characters. Usually the hardest part of my shows is just thinking what characters I want to make up. And then I have to sort through them and see which ones are really that interesting. And I take notes. When I'm walking around the street or I'm in a subway or something, I keep a little notepad with me. See? You have it with me right here. See this little notepad. And then I can like write down, if I hear somebody say something, you know, like it's a fried egg deal, which is one guy that I heard him say, it's a fried egg deal. I don't know what it means, it's a fried egg deal, but it seemed like a perfect thing for a bum on the Bowery to say. And so I keep it, and then I'll make a whole monologue out of something that somebody says. And that's how my characters get developed.
How do you become a character? They're all so different.
Usually a voice or a posture or something will tell me who the guy is, and then I'll just keep being that guy, and then I'll know from... It's hard to explain. Like, if I do a southern accent, like a real redneck kind of, come here, boy, I want to talk to you for a minute. That kind of voice, you know? Now, I know the next thing that guy's going to be doing is taking out a white sheet and putting it on and, like, putting up a... That's kind of racist or stereotype for me to do that, but that's where the monologues come from. I become the voice, I become the body, and then the guy starts talking, and I tape record it, and that's where the beginnings come from. Then I have to edit them and rehearse them and throw them out and keep some, and eventually ends up a show.
How long did it take you to put together Drinking in America with all those various characters?
This is like a Bob and Ray routine. You didn't ask me that.
Oh, I did. I'm sorry. Okay. <That's all right. laughs> Brain shorted out. Sorry.
Well, I think this is like a different... Well, I started taking notes on it around a year before I knew I was going to do it. And then around 6 months later, I started actually rehearsing the characters. And then I went to around 3 months of intense rehearsal and ending up with the guys.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about Funhouse. You did that off-Broadway.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Well, Funhouse was much darker. Funhouse was a show that I never thought was going to be seen by more than maybe 200 people, because that was a kind of the way I was very underground at the time. I made up, not like physically underground, but not a lot of people came to see my shows then. And so it was a very dark show. It has rubber fetishists in it. It has torture specialists. It has killers and all kinds of people in it.
Yeah, just
and
a real fun crowd you'd invite to a party.
Right, and they ended up on off-Broadway for around 3 months, and so a lot more people got to see them than I thought would.
There was something else that you did, too, another performance piece that was
I've done dozens of them, some with just one, just me, or some with ensembles. It's all different kinds of deals.
Well, we're going to take a look at a video right now, and then we'll be back with Eric Bogosian. Hi, we're back with Eric Bogosian, and this time we're going to talk about his acting career. Eric, you just did a thing on the Twilight Zone, and you mm-hmm. did a little bit on Miami Vice.
Yeah.
What's Don Johnson really like? Is he really very sexy, or is it just gonna...
I don't know. I didn't get to hang out with Don too much there. He was busy making it with some crocodile or something, so I didn't... No, it's a busy set. They're busy crashing up cars and setting up boxing rings and things like that we were doing. So I didn't see too much of him. But we did have fun fighting in the actual scene. That was
with Annie Golden, that show, wasn't it?
No, the show that I was in was had Fine. Rainbow Harvest was my girlfriend, who is in that show, and that was great. Rainbow's really terrific young actress mm-hmm. who, anyways, she'll tell you about that when she comes on.
Okay, well, what about the Twilight Zone, too?
Twilight Zone was great. I was doing my solo in Los Angeles, and I was...
Which solo?
Funhouse. And I was at the local shopping mall buying a shirt, and a casting agent who I knew from New York, Gary Zuckerbrot, saw me walking around in the shopping mall looking lost and said, "You have to come in and try out for Twilight Zone." And it happened that they needed a preacher type for this show who was also like a burglar. And since I do preachers and bums and every other lowlife, I was perfect for the show, and so I starred in this thing called The Healer, which was you know what they call a big break in the acting world, which is a very meaningless phrase. It's about as meaningless as the term talent. These are all pseudonyms or synonyms for other things in the world of agents in Hollywood. But anyways, it was really nice to do.
You had another career going for a while at the Kitchen. You were producing people. You gave a lot of dancers their start.
Yeah, I started a dance series at the Kitchen in 1977.
For which you will be a saint.
What?
For which you will be a saint.
that's like in the dim past, but I like dance a lot. So I wanted to, it was my job, and I didn't want to produce actors or performance people, because if you produce them, then they resent you the rest of their life. So I produced people who were performers, but who I would never run into again on my circuit, you know? So like dancers were perfect. I could hang lights for them and videotape them and, you know, get their show together, mop the floor or whatever, and not have anybody hate me for doing it. Because if you're a producer, nobody likes you. It goes with the territory. Right, Alan?
Okay. Are you going to be producing anything else or anyone else in the near future?
I'd love to get into producing again, and I have a list of people who I'd like to get things going with, but right now I've got to take care of my own little career here and stop touring so much. I tour so much that I'm never in New York, so I have to kind of get settled in New York again. And sure, I'd love to produce somebody like Ann Magnuson, who's just fabulous.
Yeah,
you know?
She is and, great. We'd love to have her on the show.
Yeah, she's hard to find, too. She was just in Japan, I guess. So.
Yeah.
But there's so much great talent that never gets seen, or who never gets seen because they're all in little clubs down the Lower East Side or something, and who really need somebody who can produce. And I know that part of the fact that things happen for me is because I know how to produce, and it's important. It's hard to make it these days if you don't have some kind of sense of how it all works.
You produce yourself, right?
Yeah, more or less. Or I work with producers. Like I work with Fred Zolo and Frank Gero, who are both Broadway producers. Or Joe Papp, or, you know,
You did something at the Edinburgh Festival not too long ago.
Yeah, I've been there a couple of times, and it's true insanity, and anybody who ever wants to get into a very insane theater scene. I've been real lucky. There's a guy I work with in England who helps me out and puts me on at these different places. That's actually Scotland, but anyways, it's exciting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I perform for British audiences. They like me over there.
Yeah, Drinking in America. How did that go over in England?
They love it. They love to see me rag Americans. They love to see me put down the American lifestyle, and of course they're completely familiar with it because they see all the TV shows that we watch. And so from Kojak to Dallas, they've seen it all. And that has a lot to do with the kind of characters I play. They also like humor that's got some kind of thought behind it, and more or less that's sort of what happens in my shows. So that's it's nice.
Speaking of your shows, you're going to be doing Drinking in America very soon in New York.
I'm going to get it up again for a little bit of to work on it some more at because it hasn't opened yet. And I'll be doing it at the Performing Garage, I think, mm-hmm. in the beginning of January.
And what do you mean it hasn't opened yet?
Open, you have the critics come and then they tear you to bits, and I haven't allowed them to do that yet because the thing needs more work.
I don't think anybody's going to tear that to bits. It's a really great piece.
Thanks.